Hello, and welcome to episode 2 of Squared Circle Gaming, taking a nostalgic look back at the good, the bad, and the ugly of pro wrestling video games from days gone by. My name's Dan Barker, and once again, I'll be your host and guide on our trip through virtual wrestling history. This week, we're taking a trip to where the big boys play and taking a look at 1999's WCW Mayhem. Before we start looking at the game, let's take a look at WCW and where the company were at the time of the game's release. Hulk Hogan was WCW World Heavyweight Champion and defeated Kevin Nash in a retirement match at the pay-per-view closest to the game's release, Road Wild, which was staged on August 14, 1999, in Sturgis, South Dakota. Despite being a three-hour show, WCW's flagship weekly show, Monday Nitro, was struggling behind WWF Raw in the ratings battle, as fans grew tired of the continuation of the New World Order angle. Nitro had beaten Raw for 83 consecutive weeks, but fell behind as WWF's Attitude Era, spearheaded by names such as Stone Cold Steve Austin and The Rock, drew higher ratings, bigger pay-per-view buys, and catapulted the company into the mainstream consciousness. As for the Mayhem game, it was released in North America on August 31st, 1999 for PlayStation, coming to Sony's home console in Europe later in the year. The title was ported to the Nintendo 64 in September 1999, and later on the Game Boy Color in 2000. Mayhem marked EA's first foray into pro wrestling gaming, as WCW needed to find a new publisher for their titles following THQ signing a publishing contract with the WWF after their working relationship with Acclaim ended. Mayhem was also the first game that allowed players to continue their matches in the backstage area of arenas, an idea that would be extended upon in WCW and EA's next title, WCW Backstage Assault, which we'll cover in a future episode, if we really have to. Before we start, I just want to give a bit of a shout out and a thank you to Will Powell, who's at SaveUsWP on Twitter, for designing the first real SCG logo. Head on over to our social media channels to take a look, and who knows, maybe it could feature on the first official SCG t-shirt. Now, speaking of Twitter, last week I went on there and asked you guys for your own personal memories of the game. Thankfully, you responded well enough, and here are some of my favourites. Dan, at Big Bag of Dan's, massive cattle prod. Cody Fulfer, the Saint, 1188. I used to love this game as a kid, and when I got tired of WWF games, one of my favourites was the code to get Master Rey Mysterio and Wolfpack Sting, but looking back, I've seen better move animation with stop-motion action figures on YouTube. Levitican, at Levitican, one of my favourite games growing up and I still occasionally play it. Javi, at Javi VIP, first WCW game with authentic entrance theme songs. The audio, crowd and commentary were awesome too. Heck, even the game intro FMV with Goldberg was badass. Jackson Herod, at Jackson Herod, at the time, it was a fun game with a deep roster. I can excuse graphics if a game is fun to play. And any game with Bobby Eaton is a game in my collection. Scott Robinson, at Scott Robinson 6. I remember at the time it had the best in-match commentary with Shivani and Heenan. Also had a great roster and a cool idea with the PPV cards you could load. James, at James9_NUFC. I loved this game. The roster was incredible, the controls were simple, and the backstage fights were strangely addictive. Hitting people with a chair never got old, although I am sure Shivani said every match I had was terrible. And last but not least, I want to say a big thank you to the guys from the Because WCW podcast for contributing. It's a fantastic show that looks back at WCW and some of the crazy decisions made by the booking hierarchy. You can find the show on all your favourite podcast platforms, and I thoroughly recommend giving the show a listen. So Because WCW, at Because WCW, DDP's mangled but somewhat decent version of Self-I-5, unlocking Mean Gene and hearing the winner of the match is me, and winning the title as Liz Mark Jr. Thank you to everyone who contributed. If I didn't get round to reading yours out, don't panic, we'll be doing the same on next week's episode. I'll go through details of how to do so at the end of this show. So at the game's main menu, the quick start option does what it says on the tin. It allows you to choose a wrestler to control before automatically choosing you an opponent and arena. If you want to fine-tune these options for yourself, then the main event option allows you to do so. Quest for the Best is the game's single-player career mode, in which you had to fight your way from the bottom of the pile right into the WCW heavyweight title picture. Thankfully, this was possible as Kevin Nash had no booking power over this game. Interestingly enough, as mentioned previously, the game allowed players to recreate pay-per-view events by utilising codes that would appear on screen during the real-life broadcast of the event. The codes would give the player access to the entire match card as well as specific costumes for the participants. The game boasts a stacked roster, with wrestlers coming in different divisions, including the various incarnations of the NWO, cruiserweights, hardcore wrestlers, and the recently reformed Four Horsemen. Other competitors become usable after unlocking them as rewards for completing challenges on the quest for the best mode. For this match's playthrough, we're going to relive the controversial main event between of 1999 Starrcade, featuring Goldberg and Bret Hart. So here we are at Starrcade, which is quite a faithful replication of the arena from that year's event. And you'll notice the little weapons sort of littered around the side of the ring. Now, the first thing you'll notice is the entrances, which, whilst poor graphically, are accurate and representative of those carried out by the wrestlers on Nitro and Thunder every week. Maybe we could have done with seeing the full effort from Goldberg with his security entourage emerging from the locker room, but maybe that's just me being unnecessarily picky. Now, in the early going of gameplay, it's easy to see that the controls are easy and simple to pick up, with a variety of two-button combinations being used to perform various moves, such as grapples, punches, strikes, and even special moves. The triangle button can be used to launch a fiercer attack on your opponent, which heightens the damage that's inflicted upon them. Now, as we head through into the entrance area, we get taken to the backstage. The game selects which area you end up in at random and can take you to such locations as the locker room, the boiler room, or even the arena ticket office, with each area littered with weapons to aid in your combat. On this occasion, we find ourselves outside in the parking lot. Now, as the action continues, I feel it's a good time to give my honest opinion on the backstage concept. An important side note here is that Mayhem was the first wrestling game I ever owned, mainly because WCW was the promotion I watched most as a kid. At the time, I thought fighting in the backstage area was really cool, and the prospect of beating the living shit out of your opponents with the weapons was brilliant. It's still fun now, but not for very long. There's only so many times you can hit your opponent with a chair or zap them with a cattle prod before it becomes boring and repetitive. I also think the backstage area feels a little enclosed, with very little room to maneuver, which defeats the object in my opinion. Don't get me wrong, I'm not expecting a full open world experience, but it just feels a little tight. As we find ourselves back in the ring, one of the most annoying points about the gameplay is that the health and momentum meter takes an absolute age to fill up and annoyingly fluctuates from one move to another. This makes it difficult to be able to fully inflict damage on your opponent, as you're forever thinking it's going to take ages for the damage meter to fill. This can get annoying when you feel that you've got your opponent in a vulnerable position and you really want to hit the finisher. Now, this is a key point here. When it comes up seeing your opponent stunned, this would be a great time to hit your finisher, especially in comparison to games where, such as WWF SmackDown, where it comes up telling you that it's able you're able to hit it. The concept of using the finisher on this game seems complicated, as you have to use one of the shoulder buttons and then waggle your analog stick to make sure in the right position to hit the finisher. This seems unnecessarily complicated. And it seems that you only seem to have a split second to execute your finisher before your opponent fully recovers. My case in point here really comes to the fore. After Goldberg just does a move like that, and yet your momentum meter still stays the absolute same, although now it's picked up a little bit. But again, no indication that you're able to hit your finisher or even a signature move, which would really be helpful. I think it's one thing that really sort of hinders the gameplay process, because you feel like you're playing for ages and ages and ages to make sure that you get into a position where you can finally win the match. So we're approaching the end of the match, so I'll sum up my thoughts on the game. Whilst I've said that it can be quite repetitive and dull at times, it's still a great game and was really ahead of its time, especially with aspects such as the entrances and the backstage areas and the pay-per-view card. But I feel that I'd probably get more enjoyment out of it if I was playing it on the quest for the best mode, as there's obviously a variety of different belts and opponents to fight for and fight against. So overall, it's a fun game, but in terms of holding up and standing the test of time, if it was a choice between playing this or WWF SmackDown, I'd probably go for SmackDown, as it just had a little bit more. It's a little bit more fun to play, if I'm going to be totally honest. However, saying that, Mayhem is still a great game, and it does hold a lot of personal memories for me. So I'm going to give it 3 out of 5 for this week. So that just about wraps up our episode. Remember to subscribe to the channel to see next week's video first, which will be the WWF Royal Rumble on the Sega Mega Drive. And remember to follow us on Twitter at squared_gaming. Give us a follow. Find us on Facebook, which you can find us by just searching for Squared Circle Gaming. And that is the same on Instagram. So I'll be back next week with another slice of pro wrestling gaming history. And until then, take care.